was not meant to,
that was not meant to get your attention. That was just a reflex action. Amen. Good to see you on this first day of the week. Amen. Hope that you had a good weekend so far. I look forward to God speaking to our hearts this morning. We're going to preach a message on spirit, how to overcome spiritual depression. And we need that, don't we? Amen. Familiar passage of scripture, but something that is very needful. We're going to look at Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 19. And what a blessing. And really the focus, again, is not on the depression. The focus is on God. Amen. And that's what I want us to see this morning, that in this times where we have these moments in life, that God is there. God Amen. Is there. He knows the everything we need. Amen. He knows exactly. You know, folks, listen, it's when you're in a position of leadership, and especially when you're in a position of pastor and you have responsibilities and different things, you want to say and do the right things, you know, for people to try to help them. Oftentimes you don't do this or say and do the right things, and you sometimes feel like it's your responsibility to do it yourself, you know, and how you might think it should be done. But really, boy, I'm still, every time I read this passage, and every time and I don't know how many times I've preached on this, this might be maybe the second or third time, I just really don't know, but I'm amazed at the difference between God and man. What we think and how we think we should do something and how God does it. You know, it's so opposite oftentimes. And God help us, amen, to be more like God, more like God. That's really what we need, is to be more like Christ, more like Him. Glad you're here. Looking forward to having a dinner with you and just be able to sit down and fellowship over the dinner and then have communion together. And then you'll have the evening free to rest and enjoy your day with God on a day that He's created, right? Amen? Yeah. This is a day the Lord has made, and He's made every day. And He says, the psalmist says, let us, amen, let us, right? Yeah. Not just myself, but let us rejoice in what?
And be
glad in it. Amen? Let's pray. Father, grateful for who You are. Lord, we just pray that You'd speak to our hearts through song, through Your word, and through the words that we might speak to one another. May we speak truth to one another. May we see each other's burdens and trials and triumphs, Father. May we share together who You are and what You desire for our lives. And we pray, God, we thank You, as Randy said in the back, they're good to have and Lisa and Ethan and Haley back with us, as he said to the choir. We rejoice to hear them sing, and I do too, Father. Just praise You, Father, for our choir and Melanie playing for us and Randy leading us, and just all the choir members, and just the practice, Lord, just everything that goes into it, Father. We just thank You, God. Thank You for the day. Thank You for a day that we can set aside, Father, to have communion, celebrate Valentine's Day and the true love of God. Father, I was thinking about the scriptures this morning, and you said that when a man loves, he's willing to lay down his life for his friends, Father. And You not only laid Your life down, Lord Jesus, for Your friends, but You laid Your life down for the enemies, which was all of us. God, there's not one of us that was not against You at one time. We thank You, Father, that You're for us, Father, because You gave us Your Son, and we're thankful, God, that we're able to call Him Lord and call Him King of Kings. And Father, we just pray that everything we do here today would be pleasing unto Him. And light our fire, Father, light our fire, as only You can. Lord, it's in Christ's name we pray. All God's people said,
Amen.
Thank you.
take our hymn books this morning, please, and turn to page 348, My Savior's Love. Let's stand and sing the first, second, third, and last, please, page 348.
Today and just listen to the music and you know they on the radio this morning the old Rugged Cross was on there and just I tell you they just don't play songs that way today folks and we really need now I'm not telling you what to do again okay I'm just giving you some friendly pastoral advice okay that so whatever you listen to make sure it's godly amen make sure whatever music you listen to is godly. But boy, oh boy, include in your listening these old hymns and these again, you say, well, I don't like those. Well,
I don't know how.
I'm going to have to tell you something there. I'm going to have to tell you something there. If you don't like them, just ask God some things, okay? Just ask God some things. I said the same thing. I didn't used to like hymns. I thought, man, I don't think I'd ever could listen to hymns. I mean, listen to these songs. They're just whatever. But let me tell you this, they're far from boring. So let me help you there. They're far from boring. They're deep. And maybe that's our problem. I'm sure it was my problem. Again, I'm still not deep, but it was my problem when I didn't like them. You know? And God help us. Say, well, that's not my preference. Well, I'm not talking about your preferences. I'm just talking about, man, if you listen to these words, and you hear these words, like the old Rugged Cross.
Amen.
And, boy, we need him, don't we? Amen.
Amen.
And we're in a spiritual rut, okay? The Christianity in the church, we need God. Amen. So any help to you and to me, that can help you, you know, get out of that, you know, and you want to be in the spiritual rut And you live in the nasty now and now, but why not enjoy God, amen, while you're in it, amen? We're going to join God for eternity and forever, amen? And help us. Help us. Paul, would you pray for us, please, sir?
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you can get us out of that rut.
Amen.
If we're willing.
Help us.
Or if we don't want to play there. Mm. Lord, I think so many times we're so easily tempted.
Sure.
And Lord, we have to be just what God says to be, and that's resist the devil. Mm. Sounds like it'd be easy, maybe. Mm. Right. But it's not, because he don't give up. Right. We give up too easy too many times.
Mm. Help us, God.
The devil doesn't, so he's going to keep on coming. Mm. We got to keep on resisting. The Lord, as the pastor said, these old songs, all you got to do is read the words.
Help us, God.
If you don't want to sing them, read the words.
Amen.
Because they're biblical. Mm-hmm. And that's what we need, God's word. Mm-hmm. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And
amen.
I pray, Lord, that you help me to hear more.
Help us, God.
So that I might have the faith that I need to get through each day. Lord, I pray that everything that's done and said today will bring glory to you. Lord, help us. That we continue to look to you in faith.
Amen.
In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Turn that on. All right. Amen. Teacher of the week is myself. I appreciate your prayers for me. Amen. As I teach and preach and just to be God would bring the messages that he desires for all of us and including myself. The Voice of the Martyrs are our missionary of the month, so we lift them up and our president. Joe Biden certainly needs our prayers. Pray for him. And then the Siler City Fire Department, certainly lift them up to the Lord in prayer this week. And excuse me. Today, again, no Sunday school. There'll be a meal after the service today. And we look forward to that. And we'll do communion right after the meal. And then no evening service tonight. Then next Sunday, the 24th, we'll be... excuse me, the 25th, it will be choir practice at 4:30, so be in your place for that. And then ladies' prayer advance on 3:21 through 3:23, and the cost is $150 plus your food. If you have any questions about that, see Karen, and you need to register by the 25th so you can get that discount. All right, amen.
King, use I and I, our sails, all the Lord.
Let's take our handbooks once again as the guard comes down, please, and turn to page 410, standing on the promises. Let's stand and sing all verses, please, page 410.
See him yesterday. We had ball games down in Wake Forest area, and he brought Colin. I mentioned Colin to you before. He's a son that has a lot of seizures and things that go on with him. And anyway, John said he's got to go back in a couple weeks. He hopes this will be the last treatments, and the cancer will be gone. And so pray for John if you would lift him up to the Lord in prayer as he goes back. Continue to pray for Paul. He has several tests that he has to continue to go through there and figure out what's going on there with him. Continue to pray for Hannah Martin. Continue to lift her up to the Lord in prayer. God would provide for her to be able to have these teeth removed soon. And do pray for, excuse me, continue to pray for Miss Elva. Continue to lift her up to the Lord in prayer. Miss Gray, pray for her, if you would. Pearl Canterbury, continue to lift her up in prayer. Continue to pray for Lynn Scarlett, if you would. Continue to pray for him. I'm glad he's continuing to improve. Stephen Overman, continue to lift him up to the Lord in prayer, if you would. And continue to pray for Suzanne. excuse me. And certainly continue to pray for all these on our prayer list that don't know the Savior. Pray God would help us to be a witness and a testimony of his grace and his mercy. I thought I turned it on. Oh, I'm red. I wasn't on go. I was on. There we go. Now I'm on go. All right. And any others this morning? Prayer request? Yes.
Pray for Kathleen Childress's family. She passed away Wednesday night.
Yes, thank you for mentioning that. I meant to put that on too. Kathleen Childress passed away.
And Pearl Canterbury is better.
Good, amen. Glad to hear that. All right, any others? Yes, Miss Marie.
Carson goes back tomorrow to run in neurology to find out any more results from the test they've done.
Okay, let's continue to lift up Carson. She goes back tomorrow. Figure out some things there, the results there. Yes, sir.
If you could pray for my coworker, Josh, his younger brother was shot and killed Thursday night.
Wow.
He was 19. I mean, just his, he lost his older brother as well 4 years ago. He's going through it. And I'm not sure about his salvation. We talked a little bit. I know he grew up going to church, and he said he grew up like having to, you know, memorize scripture and know the Bible. But I'm not sure I don't think he's walking with God in any stretch. So just pray for comfort for the family
Okay, all right, let's pray for Josh. This is a co-worker of Dalton's. His brother, 19 years old, shot and killed. And he said that his other brother died 3 years ago. And so, not sure about his spiritual condition. Pray for that, most importantly. And pray for the family as they deal with this situation.
Just continue to pray for this country.
Sure.
Corruption that's involved in it. Our judicial system and so many other areas, we just need lots of prayer.
Sure, sure. Let's pray for our country. Pray God would, again, ask where we are. Just pray God would help us to be salt and light in it also. Yes, Suzanne?
I'll continue to remember Sam. He's gotten sick several times this week, and he needs all the nourishment he can get. Randy goes Thursday. I think they're working him in for his cancer surgery.
Did you say Thursday?
He goes Thursday.
Okay. Pray for Randy Holt as he goes in Thursday for his treatment for his cancer. And then continue to pray for Sam Holt. Continue to lift him up to the Lord in prayer.
And Bethany's dad, Jim Orwin, is not doing good. He's not a surgical candidate in any way, shape, or form. In any options that they try to map out all involve surgery.
What was his name again? I'm sorry.
Jim Orwin.
Okay.
And the bladder scan was clear. There's no cancer there.
Okay. All right, let's continue to pray for Bethany's dad, Jim. Lift him up. Any others? All right, Brother Richie, if you pray for us, please, sir, I'd appreciate it. Let's pray along with Brother Richie that God would have his will and way in these situations.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and thank you for the promises and your word that you have made to us, Lord, so many, and we know that you can't lie, and all these promises will come to fruition at one time, Lord, and we thank you for the great promise that you give us if we put our faith and trust in your precious Son and his finished work on Calvary's cross, that you will take us into your family and give us eternal life, and We're so thankful for that promise, and thank you for your great love. It's this week of Valentine, on this Valentine Sunday, Lord, and thank you that you first loved us.
Amen.
And Lord, we do lift up all these different prayer requests. John O'Connor that has cancer, and just be with him and give the doctors wisdom there. We thank Brother Paul and his situation with his eyes, and we just ask you, Mike, touch and give healing there according to your precious will, Lord. We thank of Hannah Mark and the need for surgery on the teeth, to remove these teeth, and maybe the need of funds there for that, Lord, and we just pray that you might provide. We thank our senior citizen, Miss Elva, Miss Gray, and just be with them in a special way. We thank you for them, and thank you for the years that you've allowed them to be with us here on this earth, and thank you for the examples that set before us, and we just love them, and just wrap your loving arms around them during this time. We thank you for the good report from Pearl Canterbury that she's doing better. And thank you that Brother Lynn said this morning that he's doing better. And we thank you and praise you for both of these situations and just the restoring of health. And thank you for that. And be with Stephen Overman as he had these physical needs, Lord. And we just ask you might provide for him and his family. And Suzanne, and we thank you for the good report of cancer, the bladder, and we praise you for that. And just meet all of her physical needs, and just give the doctors wisdom there. And we lift up the many on the prayer list that are lost and need of salvation. We ask you might be with Kathleen Childress' family, especially, Lord, and Carson as she goes tomorrow to get the results on some tests, and we just pray that you might get a good report, if it be thy will. And we thank Dalton's co-worker, his brother was shot and killed, and just be with that family in a special way there, Lord, and even members of the family may be in need of salvation, and that they might come to know Jesus Christ even during this time, and when their hearts were tender, Lord, just minister to them during this time. And certainly, as Brother Paul said, we need help with our country. It's in bad condition, Lord, and only you have the answer. And the people of America will just turn back to you, Lord. We know that that's the answer. And we ask you might be with Sam Hope and Randy as he goes for surgery on Thursday. And I think of Bethany's dad, too, Jim, and the need there, physical needs, and others, Lord, that maybe we didn't lift up to you today, Lord, but we just ask you might be with each and every one of them. Thank you for this day, and thank you for the choir, and thank you for just all of your blessings. Thank you for this church, and thank you, Lord, each and every blessing you extend to us each and every day. And Lord, we just ask you might bless in the preaching service, anoint our pastor new and afresh, bless in the fellowship time and the communion service, and may everything be pleasing to you, Lord. And once again, we love you and thank you for your great love for us. And all these things we ask in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Ooh, amen. Help us. Boy, I would desperately, folks, desperately, desperately, desperately. Did I say desperately? We need God. We need God. We need God. I think as I was listening to, as you turn your Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 19, I was listening to Richie pray, and as I was thinking about life and all the different situations that are going on, you know, none of these things are God's fault. None of it's. It's not God, folks. It's not God. It's us. It's not God. It's not God. God gets a lot of blame for things. That's not. It's not God. You know, we need God. We need Him. What you'll find in this passage of Scripture that we're about to endeavor to try to glean some things and to preach some things to you for help is, you know, we can all get off the course. We all can, you know, not realize the purpose of our lives and what God has called us to, you know, in this life. And it's just, we are in desperate, desperate need of a movement of God in our own lives, in my life. Two times this week, well, one of them was today, but then there was another time, you know, Acts 6. Acts 6 was the passage of Scripture for the devotional, whatever I was reading, in two different devotionals, whether it was Simpson Tozer or Days of Praise. That's not neither here nor there, but Acts 6, you know, where the, you know, there was this disgruntled thing going on, you know, and with the Greeks, and, you know, and they weren't, widows weren't being taken care of, and these kind of things. And but it said there clearly that the responsibility of the apostles, these men that God had called out, was to give out the word of God and pray. Amen. That's my major responsibility for you. And it wasn't that they were not to serve. They were to serve. But ultimately, their responsibility was to give out the word of God to the people of God and to pray for the people of God. God is convicting me and showing me that I need to pray for you more. I'm part of the problem. I don't want to be a part of the problem, but yet I am. And you're part of the problem too. We're all part of the problem. Our problem is we just don't know God and seek God in prayer, and things get us off course. I know I say this quite often, but this is an amazing passage of Scripture here. This is just amazing. And what I want you to see is that God is amazing. God is amazing. It's not Elijah. Now, Elijah was this man. He was a prophet. He was a tough old boy, you know. And the prophets had to be tough, folks. They had to be hard, again, because of the people that they were dealing with. And they brought the message of God. And so Elijah, you know, was had a great high. Amen. We're coming off of 1 Kings chapter 18. I just want to, and in the introduction, I want to give you some backdrop to what we're going to talk about of this spiritual depression that Elijah got under. But man, he just come off of Mount Carmel. And man, what a great victory there, right? You know, and God had, through Elijah, he had told him, he said to the people there, he said, hey, you need to choose. You need to choose today. You know, what gods? Are you going to choose the gods of Baal and these other gods? Or are you going to choose the one true God? Why halt ye between two opinions, right? Amen. And folks, listen. There's no doubt in my mind. The people today are in between two opinions. And we're afraid, you know, to go with one or the other. And therefore, just like these people, they wouldn't speak out. You know, they just, hey, you know, they're sitting back waiting, you know, to see God, you know, move. And God did move, didn't he? You remember the prophets of Baal got out there, man, and crying out of their gods and nothing's happening. And, you know, Elijah, you know, just, I believe it's a 39-word prayer that he prayed to God. He's in communion with God. And, man, and fire came down, amen. It burned up everything, right? And they saw all this and they said, yeah, you know, God is the one true God. But we know how the heart is, don't we? God moves in these things, and then next thing you know, our hearts move away from God, just like Paul was saying earlier in the prayer. We're so guilty of these things, you know, but we need a consistency, don't we? Really, the truth of the matter is, like Vance Havner said, we do need revival, amen? But the truth of the matter is, once we experience revival, we need daily vival.
Amen.
Vival is life, right? Now, we do need re-life. Amen. That's what revival is, and revival is for the church. Amen. For the church. It's not for the lost. It's for you. It's for me. It's for the born again. Because we've been saved. We've received life, amen. Vibrance, quickened by the Spirit of God and the Word of God. We need daily revival. Amen. Daily revival, daily life. And we can lose that. And so, and then, man, Elijah, you know, you run all kinds of things in your mind. You say, man, how did Elijah, I want to tell you all this before we get into the message because it's so important. How did Elijah cut all the heads off of them prophets? You realize the strength that it must have taken to do that? And then to see all that? Now, folks, says, I don't know about you, but I'm personally not in the cutting off the heads business. Are you? I mean, you imagine what that must have looked like? Have you ever even thought about it? Well, you need to. This was, but you know what it was? It's the power of God. It's the power of God. There's no way, folks, listen, and this is what we say, well, man, no human being could do that. That would be impossible to the power of God. The power of God. That's how the fire fell down. That's how all the things took place there. It was the power of God upon the man of God. It's the only way it could happen. But oftentimes what happens to the man of God, he forgets that it's always the power of God that's going to get him through. And that's what happens to the people of God. We began to depend. Paul prayed this last week. Paul, you might not remember praying this, but you prayed this last week. You know, oftentimes what we do is we depend on our own power. Our own power. We're guilty, folks. Now, I think most people in here, if not everybody in here, is guilty. This week that just passed, this past week, you depended upon your power probably more than you did God's power.
Amen.
It's just true. Now, some of you might not have, and praise God for that. You ought to thank God if you didn't, right? We've got to get back to the right mindset and the right thinking that everything we do is because of the power of God. We could not get up this morning without the power of God. Amen.
Amen.
We could not do anything in our lives without the power of God. It's God in us, God with us. Amen. Praise God. That's what you need to see in this passage of Scripture. And that's what God wants to make clear to Elijah. And he wants to make it clear to you. And to me. It's the power of God in you and the power of God working outside of you if anything will happen to the glory of God. Amen? That's what we need. And I hope that we'll be able to see that, but I'm telling you, folks, listen, I'm thrilled that you're not God.
Amen.
I'm thrilled that you're not God. And I'm doubly thrilled that I'm not God. Amen? I'm glad that God is God, and he works differently than you and I. Amen? And I thank God that God has mercy and grace upon his people. Amen? I tell you, folks, I'm feeling one of them Pastor Fletcher moments. You know? That's what we need, folks. A little Thinking about God, though, right? Who God is. And so, let's not be too hard on the old prophet, right, Elijah. Because we've all been there in this state, I think, of spiritual depression, of, man, just wanted to, just, you know, I've talked to preacher friends, and man, they're like, I just wish God would come on back. And I wish God would come on back too, right? But God's coming back when God's coming back. No man, no woman, no boy, no girl knows when he's coming back. Do you know that? But we need to be looking for him to come back. But you know what? We ought to be laboring and understanding his purpose for the here and now. What's God doing now in my life, in your life? And oftentimes we can forget that. And we can think in our minds and our hearts. And by the way, folks, there ain't a whole lot of people serving God. I'm just telling you, folks, listen to me. There ain't a whole lot of people walking with God. I'm talking about Christians. Huh? Forget the lost world, folks. There ain't a whole lot of people walking with God. But you know what? There's still some people walking with God. I got to remember that. You know, amen. I tell you, folks, please be an encourager. Do you realize there are so many people out there to discourage the life out of you? Don't be like that. Be an encourager. I went to Walmart this morning and to pick up some things, and man, I got two responses. You know, God gave me a different way to hand out a tract today. And I was singing songs and different things. I was thinking about what we were going to sing today, and I was getting the different things for Valentine, for the bank, whatever we're doing today, the fellowship dinner. And I thought, you know, somebody in here needs to hear some good news, you know. And I handed the tract to this one lady and said, let me give you some good news. And I'll tell you what, man, it was as if I gave her something, man, that, she, you know, like she didn't want. Her response was, it just about, man, took the life out of me. I'm just being honest with you. It's just dead as a hammer. But then after I got through the checkout line there, and the self-checkout, and I gave it to this other lady, and I said, hey, so I said, let me give you some good news. And that lady took that. As a Hispanic lady there, I had never seen her before, and she took it, and she said, oh, thank you, bless you. She put life into it. There's just two kinds of people out there. Y'all realize that, right? People that put life in you, and people, man, just dry you to the bone. Man, let me be somebody, again, with God's help, amen, within me, that'll be an encourager, amen, rather than a discourager. I'm not here, again, I know, folks, there's so many people that are down and hurting, and there's just so many things today, folks. Listen, and I don't want to be a discouragement to you. I want to be an encouragement to you that God is near. The answer is God. The answer is the power of God. God can and he will in his own time, in his own way. But we know this for sure. One day we're going to be out of here. We're going to be with him rejoicing. Amen. It might not come today. It might not come tomorrow. It might not come next week. It might not come next month, next year. I can't promise you, folks, but I'm just going to tell you, God's going to lift us out of this thing. Amen. God help us to trust him and listen to him. And so in verse number one, we're going to just go down through the passage of scripture and stop and just glean some things to try to help us today to get out of this funk, get out of this spiritual rut, get out of the place where we're dependent upon something or someone else rather than God. To be our strength, and really, at the bottom line is this, it's our own selves that we depend on more than anything else. So the Bible says in verse number 1 of 1 Kings chapter 19, it says, and Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. All that Elijah had done. The truth of the matter is, it was all that God had done through Elijah. Amen. But people oftentimes give credit. But I'm going to tell you, you know, people get mad at the people of God when God begins to work in their lives. And they'll blame the human instrument. But it was actually what God had done. And withal, how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a message unto Elijah saying, so let the gods do to me and more also if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by the morrow about this time. Now, you know, I hesitated to say this. And I'm still hesitating to say it. But I'll tell you, there's a lot of wicked men out there. But man, when you find a wicked woman, man, she really wicked. Because why? I'm going to tell you the truth, folks. Listen to me now. It's natural for a man to be wicked and cruel and unkind. You understand, again, what I'm saying? And just, rah. But it ain't natural for a woman to be like that. Listen to me, folks. It's natural for a man to kill. Listen to me, folks. God made men and women different. Come on now. Y'all with me, right? Mm-hmm. We can go ahead. The food ain't going to get, well, it might get cold. I ain't going to say the food ain't going to get cold. It might get cold. But I'm going to tell you, man. Now, people don't like the truth. I'm just going to tell you that, folks. People don't like the truth. But, man, I'm going to tell you, Jezebel, man, was a wicked woman, man. The Bible goes in the book of Revelation. Richie in there, it talks about this Jezebel. Now, I don't know any crazy people who name their child Jezebel, but they got problems if they name him Jezebel, right? This was a wicked, ungodly woman. And she had the king Ahab, man. Boy, she had him, did you? You read the scriptures, man, oh my soul. Woo! I remember a man preaching a message. He said, behind every wolf in the pulpit, there's a she-wolf behind him. Now, that was that preacher, he said that. I'm just telling you what he said. This is serious business, folks. And you see this as serious business because I want you to understand. Don't you think that old Elijah wasn't no man of God? And don't you ever think that Elijah wasn't a tough man? Come on now. Y'all read about Elijah? This is a prophet, man. Elijah, you know, hey, John the Baptist came in the spirit of Elijah. Amen. Elijah wasn't no joke, folks. But let me tell you something. This devil woman wasn't no joke. Seriously wicked, ungodly. And so, she told him this, sent this messenger to him and said that he's going to take his life. And then the Bible says this, and man, this is always, you don't like to hear this about Elijah and about the man of God, but you know what? He was human. You ever had lapses in your life? You ever disappointed your own self? Of course you have. Folks, listen, if you depend upon yourself, I'm going to tell you, you're going to disappoint yourself.
Amen.
The self ain't going to make it. You need God and his power, amen. And so the Bible says here in verse 3, and when he saw that, he arose and he went for his life. You always say this. You say, come on, Elijah. Come on. You're our man. Elijah's a human being. He was concerned about his life. But you know what? God was concerned about his life. And God knew he was going to do this before he ever did it. And by the way, you know what it ought to comfort you and me? That God knows everything you're going to do today, tomorrow, next week, and for the rest of your life, God knows everything you're going to do. And he still loves you and cares for you and still wants to put his power upon you.
Hallelujah.
Now, let me just tell you, folks, if that don't do something for you, come on, let's just get right with God. Amen? God. We're talking about God, folks. I'm not talking about you and me. I'm talking about God. I'm not talking about the prophet Elijah, who was a great prophet, amen. I'm talking about God, amen. You ever cried out to God? God, why do you put up with me? God, you know God, you know why God puts up with us? Because God doesn't give up on himself. Can I tell you something, folks? When you get like Elijah, and we all do at times, and you want to give up, you want to throw up your hands, you want to do all these things, just remember, God's never going to give up on himself. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank God. Amen. So he ran for his life, and he came to Beersheba, which belonged to Judah, and he left his servant there. Okay? He left his servant there, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. He went so far away from his servant here. He came, the Bible says, and sat under a juniper tree. Now, we don't have time, folks, this morning, but I want you to look up the juniper tree and study that juniper tree. It's just this tree, even today. It's a tree of healing and all kinds of things, you know, and it's God's making, right? He made the juniper tree, right? And Elijah's gone there for comfort and rest and trying to save his life to get away from this wicked woman. The Bible says this when he got there. And he said, it is enough. Have you said that this past week? It's enough. So interesting. I was, you know, praying for different people, and there's several that I think about, and really, you know, that they need this message. You know, some are in here and some are not in here, and you know, it's just we get to a point where we think we can't go on. He said, "It is enough." He said, "Now, Lord, not tomorrow, next week." He said, "Now, oh Lord, sovereign one, right? Knows every situation and every circumstance, right? That's who he's talking to, God, the Lord." He said, "Take away my life. For I am not better than my fathers." He said, "Take away my life, folks. Listen, this is down and out, isn't it? This is serious business here. That here's a man that is a rugged man, a man of God, a man that now, folks, listen, I don't know any Elijahs today. I really don't. Here's the epitome of a prophet. Hey, man, when you think about prophet, you think about Elijah. He's one of the great prophets. And yet he says, God, I'm so down in my being that I want you to take my life. It's no good. It's no good. He's forgotten at me. He's forgotten that God has a plan and a purpose and a reason for his life. If God wants to take his life, he'll take his life. If God wants to take him home to be with him, then he will. And he did, didn't he? In the fiery chariot. Now, we know that. But he doesn't know that. Right here. He's down and out. And you know what he needs? He needs comfort. He needs rest. He needs nourishment. He needs God. And that's what people need, folks, when they're in this state. They don't need all the craziness that we try to tell them. And they just need somebody. Matter of fact, they might not need us to say anything at all. Other than say, I'll be with you. As long as God helps me to be what I need to be for you. And notice this. As he lay and slept under the juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said, "Get up, what's wrong with you?" I probably shouldn't say that, but you know, people, you know, I'm just acting like how people would be. Don't you trust God? Is that what God said? No, God meets your need and what you need. He said, arise and eat. Huh? Arise and eat. Now, folks, you're going to see what this man ate. Was, again, spiritual food by the power of God to sustain him. Amen. But you know what? He needs some physical nourishment. That's what he needed. And he's tired. He was not only tired mentally, but he was tired physically. And the angel said, arise and eat. And I like this. He said, Pastor, how did all this happen? I'll tell you, it's a miracle of God. That's how it happened. The power of God. We've forgotten that God's still the God of power and the God of miracle. And gas prices go up, the food prices go up, everything else goes up, and we run away from God. Are you kidding me, folks? God help us to run to God. He's our provider, amen. The power's in God. The churches are empty today because people are out there trying to make a living. Problem ain't we're making a living. The problem is living a life. Oh, I read something this morning. I said, dear God, help me. And I sent it out as a text today. Dear God, help me not to just be a paragraph in a history book. Please, dear God, work in me that you might do something for eternity that'll last forever. Do you know, folks, the devil has got us doped and blinded. As Paul prayed again, the scripture there, I believe it's James 5, 7, the first part of that says, submit yourself therefore to God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Do you realize that's a daily thing we need to do, praise God.
Amen.
Submit ourselves to God and resist the devil because he's keeping on coming. He ain't quitting. But I'm going to tell you what, God ain't quitting, amen. I read this morning, 1 John 4, 4, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world, amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise God for that. It ain't in my power, it ain't in your power. We can put all our power together. We ain't overcoming the devil, the flesh, and the world, folks. I'm telling you, but he's already overcoming, amen. We're in him. He said, arise and eat. And he looked. Amen. Aren't you glad God's a good cook? Say, man, listen to me. God is the greatest cook. Amen. He's the physician. Is there such thing as a cooker? He's the cooker. Amen. Wow. This is a New Testament moment in the Old Testament. Jesus was cooking in the Old Testament. Amen. Just like he cooked in the New Testament, praise God. And them disciples said, where'd that fish come from? God help us to get back to believing in the miracle power working of God. Amen. Not, look, folks, listen, I'm telling you, before God is ever going to work out here in the world, he's got to work in the people of God in the church. There was a cake baking on the coals, and a cruise of water at his head. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. God put it right where he needed it. But you know what, folks, God, now I tell you, folks, I don't know about you. I don't know how you're going to leave this place today. I hope I continue to leave in the joy and the presence of God today. I could care less about the chicken, the barbecue, the potatoes, the green beans, the key lime cake, and the blackberry cobbler, if that's what shows up today. The rolls, the salad, anything else. I'm going to enjoy eating it if I get a chance to, but I'm going to tell you what, I'm eating on the Word of God and the Spirit of God this morning. It's health. It's strength. It's the power of God. It's the only thing that's going to get you through and me through this life. But he laid down again. God knew he needed some rest. Amen? And God knows you need rest. And he knows you need nourishment. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, arise and eat. Because the journey is too great for thee. Can I tell you something this morning? The journey's too great for you.
Amen.
You see, you ain't going. You can keep going and going and going and going, but you're going to burn out. And I'm going to tell you what, many a preacher will burn you out. He'll get you going and going and going and doing all these other kind of things. You got a bit of time to spend with God and all these other kind of things. I tell you what, you better spend more time with God than you spend anywhere else.
Amen.
Folks, we got to get back to that. We in the entertainment society. Man, there's, man, you know, my buddy, bless, I'm on this tape, so I ain't going to tell you who buddy it is. I might have already told you this before. My preacher buddy said his couple coming to church and, They complainers and this, that, and the other. And he said, man, they sitting in the church service. Each one had an earbud, one in one ear and the other. The lady and the man had an earbud in each ear. And they watching a movie while the man's preaching. Now, I feel a whole lot of righteous indignation flying up in me. when I hear these things, man. I'm like, what? Just stay at the house.
Amen.
And I'll tell you, just stay at the house. If you come in here, now I'll tell you, some churches, and man, we maybe need to do that here. Just put your cell phone out there in some bucket. Amen, preacher. There's more important things than other things. Now, we didn't have the cell phone back in the day. But we had other things. We had writing notes and all these other kind of things. Pay attention to God. Amen. Pay attention to His Word. Amen. Let the Spirit of God get a hold of your heart and realize we need the power of God today.
Amen.
Right? I'm feeling a preacher Bobby Robertson moment. That's good preaching, even if I am doing it. God help us. So he touched him again. He said, "Rise and eat. The journey's too long for you, for thee, Elijah." Now, I like this. I don't know if you like it or not, but I hope you do, man. It's late. But he arose and he did eat and drink, and he went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the Mount of God. Now, folks, listen. This is our problem. So we gotta get this message before we go back to and eat and fellowship, folks. Now you got tonight off, okay? You got tonight off. So let me go ahead and preach. Amen. God help us. Right? We out here talking about the grocery store and the gas stations and all these other kind of things. And what are we going to do? I tell you what we need to do. We need to depend on God and His power. Amen. What He can... I don't know what this man ate. The Bible said He gave him some water and some cakes. But man, it was God food. Amen. The man went 40 days and 40 nights on what he ate. The power of God. Power of God is greater than your power. Aren't you glad that God puts up with us?
Amen.
Aren't you glad? Amen. The least we can do is put up with each other. Amen. Try to help each other through this life. Power of God. So Elijah, what did he need? He needed rest and he needed nourishment. But he didn't just need physical nourishment. He needed spiritual nourishment. He needed the food of God. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Amen. Aren't you glad? Praise God. Praise God. There's power in God's word. You need to live in Spirit of God in you. Amen. To illuminate that word, praise God. Do you want to trust God this morning, this afternoon, whatever it is? You want, again, not like Simon the sorcerer, that you might use this power, you know, for these other things. But you might see God work in your life and other people's lives, praise God. The people of God. Amen. Help us. God help us. God help us. God help us to realize we can go on God. Then he came hither unto the cave, the Bible says, and he lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" Now, wait a minute. You see what God did here? I really hope you see. He didn't speak to God, to Elijah this way, until he fed him up, until he got him that rest that he needed, until he gave him some spiritual strength, and he said, "Elijah, what are you doing? What are you doing here?" And you know what? Now, here's the thing, folks. It's the same principle found in Genesis chapter 3, where God said to Adam, "Where are you?" It wasn't for Adam. I mean, it wasn't for God. It was for Adam. And this is for Elijah. God knew where Elijah was. He knew why he was there. He wants Elijah to admit it to him in his heart. He wants to bring out the real problem. Jezebel's not the real problem, folks. Can I tell you, the world, the flesh, and the devil are not the real problem. Well, the flesh is. We're the real problem. It's not with God has all power, folks, amen, to help us overcome any circumstance or any situation that we might be in. It's us. And he said, yeah, man, this is what I tell you, man. This is us. I hope you see yourself here, because this is you and me. We're talking here. We're talking to God. And he said, I've been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts. For the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, slain thy prophets with the sword. And boy, oh boy, I only am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Y'all ever been like that? You ever thought about that in your own heart, man? I'm doing right. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. All these other kind of things. And why? We all do. Because we all have flesh. We all wonder. Folks, but listen. Here's the deal, folks. Here's the deal this morning. Or we're past 12 o'clock, in case you didn't know. We are. But here's what I'm going to tell you. It don't matter if none of you change. I can't make an excuse for not changing myself. I got no excuse. I got no excuse. I say, well, God, people just won't listen today. They're just hard-headed, all these other kind of things. God, we're in this state, blah, 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 blah. And all along, God's power hasn't changed for my own life. Oh, George Law used to say, he said, you could raise your kids in the pits of hell and they could still walk with God. Yikes. You know why? It's the power of God. It's not you. It's not me. But we keep making excuses for ourselves and for others, don't we? Now, we need to have, I'll tell you, folks, don't be so hard on others. Be more hard on yourself. Now, don't be too hard on yourself. I don't want you to do that. But, hey, be more hard on yourself than you are on others. That'll help you tremendously. And it'll give you some compassion for other people and what they go through. So he says all that. He said, now, folks, just a little bit ago, you know, he told God to take his own life. You know, I'm ready to die. You know, he really wasn't ready to die, folks. And neither are you. Because you know what? I'm telling you, if you're saved by the grace of God, you want to live. Don't get past that, folks. The devil can get us so down and out that we want to die. We just don't want to live anymore. We can get that way. But you know what? That ain't the way, child of God. God wants to bring us out of that. Now, I tell you, he might not bring you out today. He might not bring you out next week. He might not bring you out. I don't know when he'll bring you. But I tell you, God, listen, we want to live. God's given us life. Amen? Our feelings, they mess with us. Your feelings ever mess with you? They mess with us, folks. God help us. And so, he said, they come and take my life. And he said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. The angel did. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great strong wind, tornado, rent the mountains and break the pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. He wasn't in that tornado, hurricane. And after the wind, an earthquake. The Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. The Lord was not in the fire. And after a fire, the still small voice. I pray you hear the still small voice this morning, this afternoon. And it was so when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in his mantle. And he went out and he stood, entering in of the cave. And behold, the voice, there came a voice unto him and said, what doest thou here, Elijah? He said it again, repeated it again. And he said, I've been very jealous for the God of hosts because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, only left and seek my life to take it away. I'm telling you, folks, if you cannot see the mercy and the grace of God in this, something's wrong with you. God's trying to change the man's heart towards him, and it's about God and not about himself. Amen. And he's trying, but he's fighting it. Right? We all do. We all fight these things. And this is what God says to him. We'll close. You remember earlier, Elijah had his servant there with him. Remember, he left his servant behind, and he went out by himself. Now, all these things that he did was, you know, he was running from himself and running from God and the circumstances and the situations, trying to protect his life. That's, you understand that, right? Folks, listen to me. He's down and out. He cries for God to kill him. Is that not true? But just a little bit ago, Jezebel says she will kill him. Why didn't you just stay there and let him kill him? Because he really didn't want to die. He really didn't want to die. And guess what? God knew that better than he knew it. God knows you're going to go through things, folks. He's not afraid of you, your feelings, or anything else that you might say to him. By the way, you ought to say more to him than you say to anybody else. Because other people ain't going to understand, folks. They don't understand. Now listen to me, folks. I'm trying to think if this song is a wrong song. That's when we say, for he is a, what does that go when he said, he is a jolly good fellow, for he is a jolly good fellow, for he is a jolly good fellow. Comes in.
There's nobody can know.
Okay, so it's not a bad song, okay. I just want to make sure, you know. I'm a pretty jolly good fellow. I'm a jolly guy, you know. But I get down and out too. Everybody gets down and out, you know. And so some people might say, they might say, well, that's for you. You know, I hear this in my head, what people say. They say, well, you're that kind of person, or you're this, or you're that. You know, and there are different personalities, folks, but I'm just going to tell you, God wants you to have the love, the joy, and the peace in your heart too. Amen. In life. Because you have the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. He wants you again to have and experience him. And it doesn't mean that you're not going to have darkness. Doesn't mean that you're not going to have suffering. Doesn't mean you're going to have trial. You're going to have all those things. But God understands all that. He wants you to depend upon his power and who he is in your life. So notice what happens here. What God does. So God gave him rest. God gave him nourishment. And then God gave him a friend. Gave him a friend. Somebody to come along with him. I tell you, folks, there's not very many people serving God. It's hard to find somebody to serve God with. Amen? And let me just tell you this. Husbands and wives ought to be serving God together. Amen, preacher. Mm-hmm. Amen. God help us. But you see, we're in a day-to-day, man. We're going in two different directions. We got all kinds of ideas and all kinds of things. And boy, oh boy, and we need to recognize that we need God. And I tell you, we need people beside us. God knows that best. Amen. This is what he said. And the Lord said unto him, go return unto thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. He never did that. Elisha did it in his. And the spirit of Elijah. And Jehu the son of Nisha shalt thou anoint king over Israel. He never did that either. But he did in the spirit of Elisha. Elisha did it. And the Elisha the son of Shaphat of Amriel shalt thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. So he told him three things there. Two of them he never did. But Elisha did it in the spirit of Elijah. So it was him actually doing it according to the way God had it planned. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. He said this, I want to remind you, yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed down unto Baal, and every mouth which hath not kissed him. Elijah said, God, I'm running for my life. Israel has fleed you. There's nobody serving you but me. It's just me, God. I'm the only one that has your name at stake here and your honor. And they're going to take me out of here. You know what Elijah got? You know what he got, folks? He got the too important syndrome. Hey, I'm too important, God. I'm too important to lose my life. God help us. And I'm going to tell you, folks, when we get like that, boy, oh boy, help us. There are no big I's and little U's in the plan of God. Now, God wants to use you and me. He wants to. But I'm going to tell you, it's up to God and the power of God, whatever he wants to do. Amen. And you see, Elijah, God, in his spiritual depression and his down and outness, God came along. And you see, folks, what I want to tell you, God knows exactly what you need. You know, oftentimes, you know what we run from, folks, when we get depressed and get down? Physical food. When you're down and out, you just don't want to eat. You know what I told somebody? And I'm wrestling with a lot of things yesterday and just trying to help somebody. Man, they're struggling in different things. And I said to them, I said, hey, I said, they said, you know, I don't want to eat, you know, and this, that, and the other. And I left it alone. And then I finally just said, I said, you sure you don't want to eat? You want to eat, sir? I said, well, she said, and this is what they said to me. They said, are you going to eat? I said, yeah. I said, I'll eat. They said, okay. God was at work. He just wanted me to take them and get them something to eat and let them be nourished and get their mind off the problems and their difficulties. You know, so many people, and I'm telling you, folks, young people today are battling. They're infiltrated with this world and satanic stuff and just all kinds of things is battling them. And you know what they need? They need somebody to come alongside them and say, I love you. God loves you more than I do. And I want to help you in some way or another. I hope and pray that you and I leave this place and not just desire to be in the devil's history book of having a paragraph written about you and you did nothing or allowed God to do nothing for you in this world in eternity. Now, one, that's an embarrassment to us that God saved us, and yet we go to God empty-handed. But I'm going to tell you, it's more so, again, reproach on Christ and what he did on the cross of Calvary. When we do not allow him to show his power in our hearts and lives that we might be what he'd have us to be. And we run from the Jezebels of the world. And we're scared half to death to say anything about this movement that we're in. By the way, folks, we're in a Christian movement that ain't Christian. It ain't Christian. And somebody got to say something about it and not be scared. But not in their own power. It's got to be in God's power. Because God's the only one that can change this thing. But hey, what about you? What about me this morning? Let's stand to our feet. I know it's not morning, folks. You need to get used to saying morning. But what about you? What about me? Where are you in the depths of your soul? You realize that's what matters, right? It don't matter. You can put a smile on the outside of your face. But inside, there's struggle, there's battle. What do you want? Your own power? You want to depend upon yourself to get you through, or you want the power of God, the still small voice, to come and say to you, I love the still small voice. I'm telling you, folks, what people are looking for is tornadoes, fires, and earthquakes, signs. And all along, God's there. And you can't hear his voice because you're looking for something else. And he says, I got the power. I can help you. Randy's going to come, Miss Melanie. Just surrender it. I'll get you through. I'll help you. Trust the Lord, the Sovereign One, The one that knew the circumstance you'd be in today before you ever got to him. He has the power to help you through them. He has the power to help me through. We need him more than anybody else or anything else. We need him. We need him. What a great day. What a great day to praise him and to worship him. What a great day to get our hearts right before him. Allow him to revive us and then say, God, would you daily help me to have revival? Life, 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 life. Oh, folks, let's not get a me syndrome. And I'm too important. Syndrome. None of us are. None of us are. But I tell you, he is. He's most important. He's all powerful. He wants to help us. Great is our help. Let's pray. Father, we're grateful for who you are. Oh, God. Oh, God. Help us all. Help us all, God. God. It's too easy to say words, Lord. It's too easy, Father God, to disobey, to make excuses. God, give us the strength and the power. Feed us your word, and we might live. We know this 40 days and 40 nights is your testing number. It's your perfection. It's your working your plan. God, help us to go through this time and trust you. And may we go out of here one day, again, we will, and we believe and trust that this chariot fire rapture is a picture of the church. Father, Elijah did get right with you. Father, he lived the rest of his days, not sinless, but trusting you and your power. We pray we do the same, which in Christ's name we pray. Hymn number 591, Have Thine Own Way, Lord, you come with God's book into your heart. Let him have his way. Depend upon his power and not upon yourself. Let our senior saints go first, and remember there's somebody coming behind you. Doesn't mean that you don't get, you know, but man, whatever you get, make sure you eat it, right? And don't want to waste, and but got a good meal, and pray that it'll be a blessing to us. Let's have a word of prayer. Randy Smith will pray for us for the food, and let's enjoy our fellowship. And again, let our senior saints go first.
Dear Lord, thank you for this day, and thank you for the privilege we've had to be in your house, and thank you for the message that we've heard today. And Lord, help us to meditate on it, Lord, and realize that even in times when we get down, Lord, and we in our flesh we don't know which direction to turn, Lord, we know that you're there and you'll help pick us up and you'll help strengthen us, and Lord, show us exactly what you'd have us to do. And I pray, Lord, that you'll just help us to remember that whenever we face a trial in our lives, and Lord, trials are coming. And I just pray, Lord, now that you would just bless this food that's been prepared to the nourishment of our bodies. And give us a good time of fellowship, and then just blessing the communion this afternoon. Just thank you, Lord, for this church and for what it means to me, and Lord, just for the lighthouse it is in this community. In your name we ask it, amen.
Amen.
Okay.
Sure about that?
I'll make it.
Look who it is.